The Watchman's voice has been moved to 9 o'clock on Tuesdays and Fridays. You can still catch your favorite show, The Watchman's Voice, on Tuesdays and Fridays, but now at 9 o'clock, only on Worship Center Radio, the platform of champions.
It's 9:01.
From Detroit to the nations, you are listening to the world's number one Christian station, Worship Center Radio, the platform of champions.
But if the watchman sees the sword coming and does not blow the trumpet to warn the people, and the sword comes and takes someone's life, that person's life will be taken because of their sin. But I will hold the watchman accountable for their blood. Son of man, I have made you a watchman for the people of Israel. So hear the word I speak and give them warning for me.
Y'all know what time it is. It's 9 o'clock on a Friday. Let's get it going! Yeah! And it's on! The Watchman's voice, y'all! We're getting it in tonight! Yeah! Okay, if y'all don't know already, this is The Watchman's Voice. Welcome to The Watchman's Voice. Hey, we're doing a big thing tonight. We're going to talk about the Satanistic statue that's in Detroit, the Statue of Baphomet. We're going to talk about what we talked about on Tuesday on the last show, when we talked about the church and the five things that kept the church from progressing in the last 100 years. All that today on The Watchman, and we're getting an update from Keith Bar in Mexico. On The Watchman's voice, y'all, in the zone. That's right, it's The Watchman's voice, y'all. Welcome to Friday. Some people would like to say, thank God it's Friday. But I thank God for every day. So welcome to Friday. It's on. Look, we got a packed show for you. I got a lot of things going. Keith Barr gave us an update, and it's a long update. I want y'all to listen. He is out there doing the thing. He's in Mexico. He's been out there for a while. The Lord told him, hey, if you don't go to Mexico, I'm going to take you out of here. So he got up and he went to Mexico, just like what the Beverly Hillbillies did. They said, the good Lord told him, hey, move away from there. Said California is the place you ought to be. Well, he told Keith Barr, Mexico is the place he ought to be. And that's what he did. He packed up and went to Mexico for a few months. And he's been doing crusades down there, healing the people and preaching to the people. You got to hear what he has to say. It is powerful. Also on the show, we're going to talk about what we gave for homework on Tuesday. Tuesday, we gave homework to the people. Let me turn myself up a little bit so y'all can hear me. So there's no reason you can say, I can't hear what he's saying. Look, Tuesday we gave homework. The homework was to study what we talked about in the five things. We only got to one thing. We talked about religion, and that was the only thing we got a chance to. But I got some more stuff to add to it. So, man, this is end up going to be a series. It seems like it's going to be a series. Man, I've never done this before. This is new to me, y'all. I've sat down, and I decided, you know, I'm going to tell the people what's going on in the church today. And I'll take all the flack. I don't care what people saying that I'm being too hard on the church and things like that. You know what I care about? I care about displeasing God more than I care about displeasing you. So y'all can get mad at me all you want, because it ain't going to change. That's part of the being a watchman. You know, you have to take the good with the bad, but you have to warn the people. And I'm telling you, it's coming. The times are changing. It's coming. We might not see Jesus in our lifetime, but I'm telling you, the time is changing to where the Bible is starting to come to life. All right? So let's pray real quick. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before you, thanking you for Friday. And then always, Father, I ask that you bless my heart. Give me the mind to speak to the people. Touch my mouth so I may say what you want me to say and not how I feel. So, Father, in order to not offend you, Father, please guide me and tell me what to say. As always, Father, I don't care about offending the people, because sometimes the truth is offensive, but it has to be said. And Father, I ask that you bless the people that are listening so they may receive it in Jesus' name. So anyway, let's get this in real quick, because this is the part where I get to play around. I gave you homework the other week, and the homework was to find a statue before Saturday. Did anybody find out where the statue was? I mean, this statue is going on a mission. It's hiding. You know what? Whenever the devil gets gets pushed around by Jesus, because he always does, he goes into hiding and running because he can't stand against the Christians, or he can't stand against the real people of God. Let me put it that way, because some Christians aren't real. He can't take standing against real people of God. And I think some of the people of God, the real ones, stood up and forced them into hiding. So run. Run, Satan, run. So we have an idea here of where it may be unveiled at. And there's only two places. So I need people to kind of check it out and find out where it's going to be. We said the Charles H. Wright Museum, because they have the room for a statue like that. And we said the DIA. DIA, they all, both of those places in downtown Detroit have room for that. And I think what they want to do is really unveil the statue here in downtown Detroit. So it's a big deal for them. It's a big deal for them, but it's a bigger deal for us to be able to combat what the enemy is trying to do in Detroit. The murder rate in the last couple of months since that statue has been here has skyrocketed. I don't know if you have seen it, or if you paid attention, or if you're sitting around complaining about how many people are getting killed, but it has been because of that. But first, before we get into all that, we're going to go into Keith Barr Report. Apostle Barr, how you doing down there in Mexico? Tell us, what's going on?
God bless you, Juan, and all my other listeners and friends back home in the United States. This is Apostle Keith Barr, and I've been down here in Mexico for revival for almost 2 months now. The Lord told me that I had to come. And he would take me out of here. I was on my deathbed, and God gave me a miracle and immediately raised me up. My lungs were so full of fluid that the doctors told me that my kidneys were shutting down, my liver was shutting down, my pancreas was shutting down, and all my organs, and I was about to collapse from a heart attack. At any time, he says, I was about to go into convulsions, and after that, I would have went to a coma and died. He said, I got to the hospital just in time. So I'm trying to give you the short version. But I told him I had to be out in a week, because the Lord told, well, I didn't tell them, but I knew I had to go to Mexico, but I told him I had to leave to preach. Because the Lord told me if I wasn't here by the 1st of June, that he would cause me to drop dead of a heart attack. And I had to stay here 3 months, and to help bring revival to this nation. And let me tell you that God has done so many miracles. See, he raised me up and healed me. I asked the Lord to avenge me of my adversary. Don't just heal me, but because the devil afflicted me, to make me younger on the inside. And it's just amazing. The doctors were amazed. The heart doctor, and then they told my doctor, said for me to be 58 years old and no trace of plaque or in my arteries or veins, no blockage in my arteries and veins, it says just totally remarkable. My doctor said my blood pressure is the blood pressure of a teenager, and I don't look like no teenager. And so, I mean, God has just healed me and restored me. I haven't felt this good in 20 years. I asked God to avenge me and add more years into my life that I could work for the ministry. And he has done that. And let me tell you, we have just seen miracle after miracle down here in Mexico. We've ministered to, I don't know how many people we've ministered to. We've seen hundreds and hundreds of miracles. Sometimes there's so many in one service that I literally lose track. All types of miracles, blinded eyes open, so many people here with knee problem, back problem. Many of these you can look at on my, some of them on, well, actually just a fraction of them on my website, on my YouTube site, channel, Rev Keith Barr. Just go to YouTube and type Rev Keith Barr, or you can go to my Facebook, Apostle Keith Barr. And you can see many of the miracles that have happened, and the lives that have been touched. And it's just awesome to see what God has done. So many have been saved and filled with the Holy Ghost, and so many lives have been touched. It was one young man I called him out and ministered to, and I told him that God has more for him, but there was something in his heart that was holding him back. And that I was afraid he was going to miss what God has for him because these things, whatever it was, that he wouldn't let go. And I ministered to him several times. I was in this church a couple of times. And he finally got a breakthrough. And he admitted to me, well, he told me that what the problem was, he had been so horribly abused, him and his mother, by his father, that he hated his father. And he swore that when he became a man, that one day he would kill his father. And he couldn't let his hatred go. And he was so traumatized by the things that his father did to him that he didn't trust any men. He could not bind. He had no good relationship with any man. He could deal with women because he loved his mother. And even the pastor, he couldn't get close to the pastor. He would talk to the pastor's wife. And he said, but how I ministered to him and prayed for him, it broke that spirit in him. And he said that he has never known a father's embrace. And he asked me to, he hugged me. And so to know a father's embrace. And he hugged me three times crying. You know, God just broke that spirit in him and delivered him. And to be 24 years old and have never known a father's embrace, you know, but God did really a miracle to him, for him. And Sunday night, I was in a town called Tokiman. And it's the iguana capital of the world. And but they've eaten most of them. They're nearly extinct. But in the service, there was this one girl. Well, actually, her father had come in the service, and he had back trouble for years, and he got healed. And so he went back to get his daughter, and he brought her up for her to be healed. And she was kind of hunched over. And but she was angry. She looked like she hated her father. She didn't want to be there. And she came up for prayer. I knew it would be pointless for me to pray for her at that point. And so I began to talk to her a little bit, and then I asked, could I talk to her after service? And so after service, I talked to her and showed her how, tried to explain to her how this bitterness was going to destroy her and anger. I didn't know what it was at first, but I kept talking. I talked to her for about almost an hour before I could finally seem like get a breakthrough. And all the time, she's giving me attitude, rolling her eyes, like she didn't want to hear it, folding her arms and all her body language. She just didn't want to hear it. She didn't want to be there. But after about an hour, I explained to her, I said, I have no reason to talk to you other than God has laid you on my heart. And I says, you know, I'm not getting anything. You probably never see you again after tonight. And I said, but God wants to, you know, do work in you. And so she finally admitted that her mother had died about 6 or 7 months ago. And she blamed God, and she hated God. And she, her father wasn't in her life. He was an alcoholic, but he'd gotten, recently gotten saved about 6 or 7 months ago. And she hated her father. And I tried to explain to her her father's, you know, position, how he loved her and everything. And it didn't mean anything to her. But I told her, you know, I could identify with her anger because I was angry when my father died when I was 19. And I understood her rebellion because there was a time I was rebellious, short time against my mother. And I explained to her, I said, but you're going to be taking that anger with you wherever you go. It's going to affect every relationship, every job. It's going to affect every man you get involved with, your children. You're going to carry this bitterness and anger. You're going to make your life miserable. You can never have a good job. Because you're going to be poor. You're going to ruin your life by all this anger and bitterness that you have. And so I prayed for her and her back. Also, she had pain in her back. And because she had fell and hurt her back when she was a kid. And then other girls that hated her when she was writhing on, in pain came and kicked her in her back. And stomped her in the spine. And she's been hunched over. She was about 15, 16, looks like. And she's been hunched over ever since. But God healed her that night. And then God healed her. I said, you have to ask God to take this bitterness out of your heart. And she prayed, and we prayed for her, ministered to her. And she, I told her to hug her father, and she just broke down and cried and sobbed. And it was such a powerful embrace. Her father hugged each other for a long time, just crying. Beautiful sight. It wasn't hardly a dry eye in the church for the few of us that was left, because this was like an hour after service. But I just thank God for allowing me to be a blessing to people down here in just so many ways. So many, you know, when the Lord told me I was going to become and pouring into pastors and ministers, and I said, Lord, I don't know anybody down here. I only know two preachers in all of Mexico. And you show me I'm be ministering to many pastors. And I said, why should they listen to me? I don't speak the language. And you know, I can preach to interpreter, but why should they listen to me? And everything that God has told me has come to pass. I had a meeting this week with about 15 pastors. And so we're getting together to try to do a open air meeting. And God has just done so much. It's miracle after miracle every night. There was the other night we went to in front of the hospital and started ministering to people in front of the hospital, and people started getting healed. One woman had the Dungy fever that's transmitted this down here through a virus. It's actually, it's worldwide through this mosquito virus, and it's very, very painful. It just attacks the joints and the bones. And people have nausea and vomiting and terrible headaches and pressure behind the eyes and everything. And so there's nothing really doctors can do for you. And some people died from it, but I prayed for and God healed her. There was another man that came up who had been in the service 2 weeks ago when I prayed for him. He was an accident victim, and he was in pain with his legs and knees. And also there was one young man who was in an accident, and he had problems from his knees, and I guess he never got his bone set, but for his wrist, bone was bulging in his wrist. And so I prayed for him. He had been in pain ever since this accident, and God healed him of his pain and everything in his knees, but his wrist, we couldn't see anything different. So I prayed for him about 2 weeks ago, and so he told me last night that the next day when he was sharing with somebody how God healed him, but he still believed in God for his wrist, he turned his wrist over and the bone was healed. And we've seen someone else who had bone spurs in his leg. You can feel that. That was dissolved. We've seen cancers going away, tumors going away instantly. Of course, not everyone is healed, but I'm seeing like 95, at least 95% of everyone that we're praying for being healed. God is just doing a tremendous, tremendous work. And so some of this, as I said, you can see on my website. These are just a fraction of the miracles. We don't have time to put everything on Facebook and these others. But also I want to encourage you to continue to pray for us, because we're trying to bring revival to this whole nation of Mexico. And God is just connecting the pastors and everything. It's just wonderful what God is doing. And so when I finish here, I'm going to leave here. I'm going to come back to the United States, and we want to bring forth revival in the United States. We want to start having crusades. There's so many people that are sick and got knee trouble, back trouble, all types of sickness and things. And we want to start doing some crusades and things in Detroit. So I want you to pray with us and stay tuned for our, to our website and radio broadcast here. Thank Mom for giving us the opportunity to share with you all these wonderful, wonderful things that God is doing. And there was another man in Puerto Vallarta who, for 17 years, about 15 years, he'd been in tremendous pain. He fell off a ladder on his farm and fell into some metal. And the metal went into his spine and his neck and his spine near his neck and everything. He went to the doctor, and the doctor told him, he said, I guess they got a little bit out, but they said, we can't get all of it out. They said, if we do any further, you have one or two choices. You can either live with the pain, or we can take the chance, but you may end up being paralyzed for the rest of your life. And so he said, well, I'll live with the pain. I do not want to be paralyzed from the neck down. And so for 15 years, he's had this pain. But I prayed for him, and God totally healed him from this. And we, another lady, she had a tumor. And she was pregnant, and the tumor was threatening the life of the child, and God instantly dissolved that. I mean, it's just amazing the things that God is doing. I'm hearing about sickness I never heard of before and saw before, but God is just doing some awesome things. So we're looking forward to coming back to the United States, and we want you to stay tuned, because we want to start bringing God's healing power to this generation. And many of you are suffering needlessly. Jesus said, I come that you may have life and have life abundantly. And Satan is a thief, and he wants to steal your life and steal your health. But God wants you to be healthy, while you're down here. He don't want you miserable and going in pain in your existence. A lot of people are amazed at how long I pray for people. I pray for people for hours, in the service, in the long line of people. And I take my time, because sometimes it takes people time to be healed. And I've been sick, so I have great compassion for the sick. I do want to see everybody healed, everybody that comes to my line. Matter of fact, I kind of take offense. I'm surprised when a person does not receive healing. And so I want to see everybody healed. And so we have to build up their faith so they have faith to receive. But anyway, I'm going to sign off now, and thank you for listening. And remember to keep us in your prayers. And also, we need finances. What I really wish we could do is I'd like to raise money to get a big tent, because that would really work here in the United States, in Mexico. Because they're used to outside. Some of the churches don't have air, and they have the big doors and windows open anyway. Outside service wouldn't be that much a shift or change for them. And a tent is its own advertisement. People would drive by. And so we could be in a location for, 10 days or so. And people, many times I go places and there are a couple of days, people keep coming back looking for me. They bring more sick people. And sometimes when they find out that I'm not there, some stay in the church and sometimes they leave. But if I was in a place where they knew they could come, like a tent, and the leaders, I thank God the people here are just wonderful. God is just touching their hearts. It's really a blessing to be a blessing. I thank God for using me and using my life and give me a heart for people and putting their heart in my heart and my heart in theirs. And we're doing a great work down here. And so we ask you to pray for the revival of Mexico. And remember, go to my website, KeithBarr.com. And my YouTube is Rev Keith Barr. And it's B-A-R-R. And Apostle Keith Barr is my Facebook site. So God bless you and keep us in your prayers. Amen.
The Lord gave me this song in a dream. And when I woke up, I knew that was a healing song. And I knew that God had ordained that because I was going through some spiritual pain of my own. And it was speaking to my soul. And I just wanted to encourage other people who might be going through pain, but God is a healer. Earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. There's no situation that you're going through that's so difficult that God cannot fix it. I don't care what your friends say. I don't care what your family says. I don't care what whoever's around you says. There's healing. For your soul and for your spirit. So we want you to be encouraged tonight and not be discouraged. Joy comes in the morning. Know that God is nigh.
Okay. Don't try to fight the battle. I wanted yourself, to play a little bit of that so you can just. I didn't want to come right out of Keith, Apostle Keith, and just go into just blazing. So I wanted to keep a little bit of the worship and people celebrating the fact that what he's doing down there. And remember to pray for Apostle Barr. Don't just hear what he's doing down there and not pray for him. Pray for him and pray for the revival that's going on in Mexico. So, anyway, I wanted to do two things. Oh, I forgot. You could call us at 248-796-8241. And we're giving away tickets. And let me see. If you're watching me on Ustream, you can see me shaking up this little box because I need a number. Oh, there's a number right there. And let's see. What caller is going to get? The eighth caller is going to get some tickets. I see. Oh, a ticket. Let's say a ticket to our Black Tie Affair coming up on August 22nd. It's a night of elegance at the Crown Plaza Hotel in downtown Detroit. And I will give tickets to the eighth person that calls, 248-796-8241. So let's get back into what we've been talking about. And we went into religion last week, and we talked about the few things. We used Acts 25, 1 through 21, and Mark 7, 1 through 9. So if you didn't hear us last week, write them down real quick so you can go back and study in and read them. It's Acts 25, 1 through 21, and Mark 7, 1 through 9. They is having a big old concert down here anyway. Anyway, let's talk about greed now. Let's get into greed. See, greed is one of the reasons that that the church can't prosper. I mean, you think I'm kidding? Greed has always been a problem in the church. Greed has always, it's not been a time where greed wasn't a problem in the church. Let's go to our first one, Jeremiah 6. Now, I need y'all to write this stuff down. If y'all gonna listen to me, I need y'all to write it down. Jeremiah 6:10. We're going to start at verse 10. But Jeremiah 6, verse 10. Look at this thing. Jeremiah 6. Let's go to Jeremiah 6. And we're going to start at verse 10. Let's see. What did the Lord say? Jerusalem at this time was under siege. And I think the Lord was getting ready to give them over to somebody else because Israel was disobedient. Let's read Jeremiah 6:10. To whom can I speak and give warning? Who will listen to me? Their ears are closed. He's talking about Israel. So they cannot hear. The word of the Lord is offensive to them. They find no pleasure in it. But I am full of wrath of the Lord, and I cannot hold it in. Oh, this is the prophet Jeremiah. I'm sorry. Prophet Jeremiah is talking about Israel, and the Lord gave him a word to give to them, but they're not listening to him. So let's continue to read. Pour it on the children in the street and on the young men gathered together. Both husband and wife will be caught in it. And the old ones that weigh down with years. Their houses will be turned over to others, together with their fields and their wives, when I stretch out my hand against those who live in the land, declares the Lord. Did I read that wrong? Because from the least to the greatest, all are greedy for gain. He's not talking about from the poor people to politicians. He's talking about everybody. From the least to the greatest, all are greedy for gain. Prophets and priests alike. Jeremiah is saying the prophets and the priests are the greedy, and they're all alike. He's meaning from the littlest people to the greatest people, prophet and priest, from poor people to the top row of the priesthood, they're all alike. And they all practice deceit. Let me read verse 13 again so it'll roll right in. From the least to the greatest, all are greedy for gain. Prophets and priests alike all practice deceit. They dress the wound of my people as though it is not serious. Peace, peace, they say, when there is no peace. Are they ashamed of the detestable conduct? No. They have no shame at all. They do not even know how to blush. So they will fall among the fallen. They will be brought down when I punish them, says the Lord. So the Lord is talking. He's talking through them, to them, through the prophet Jeremiah. Let me slow down a little bit. The Lord is talking to Israel through the prophet Jeremiah. And he's telling them, nobody is safe from this. From the least to the greatest, he's going to punish everybody because everybody has been practicing in deceit. And he is not happy with it. And none of them in that city, in Jerusalem at that time, nobody has shame. Kind of sounds like the way it is today in the church. Nobody in the church has any shame for anything that they've done. Everything is for gain. Anytime, and I'm going to say this, and I know a few of you going to get mad, but I'm going to say this. Anytime you go on TV, so you know it's a televangelist I'm talking about, somebody that has a show on TV, he's a preacher. Anytime you go on TV and sell pieces of your T-shirt, some oil, and some sand from Israel, and you selling it to the people, but you're not trying to sell it, but you're saying if you give a donation of this amount, it's the same thing as selling it. What makes you think that you can sell God to people? You can sell a blessing to people. Let me get out of this one. Let's go to 1 Corinthians because that part is going to make me mad because they've been doing it for a long time. Jeremiah said nobody was ashamed at that time of what they were doing. They all was practicing deceit from the prophet to the priest, the prophets of the Lord. You go to a church and a prophet is coming in and he give a good word and everybody's standing up clapping and the Holy Spirit is coming out. Then they break the spirit and they grieve the Holy Spirit by saying, for $100, stand in this line. If you have $100 to give, stand in this line and receive the apostle's blessing. Come on now. Or receive the prophet's blessing. Come on now. They didn't do that in the real church. They didn't do that nowhere. We created that. That's some fragonacle bull. Oh my goodness. Let me go to Corinthians before I get mad. Corinthians 5:11, if you're following along. 1 Corinthians 5:11. Woof. That almost made me mad. Uh-oh, let me find out where my book is. 1 Corinthians 5. All right. We're reading 1 Corinthians 5. We're going to go down to verse 11. And, man, I have to calm down because of the simple fact that I get mad when I see people on TV trying to sell God to somebody, or the prophets and the apostles standing in line saying, receive the apostles' blessings by standing in this line when you give $100 or $500. That to me is, that's evil to me. That's evil. Okay, so 1 Corinthians 5:11 says, but now I'm writing to you, this is Paul writing to the church in Corinth, but now I'm writing to you that you may not associate with anyone who claims to be a brother or sister, but is sexually immoral or greedy, an idolater or a slanderer, a drunkard or a swindler. Don't even eat with such people. Maybe I need to read that again. And let's go to verse 12, because he says, what business is it of mine to judge those outside of the church? So, okay, that verse sets my spirit on fire. You know why? Because when I hear people say, who are you to judge? When I'm talking to the Christians, when I say something that the Christians shouldn't judge the gays so hard because there's too much homosexuality inside of the church, and you say to me, who am I to judge? Then Paul says, what business is it mine to judge those outside of the church? Are you not to judge those inside? God would judge those outside and expel the wicked person from among you. So we're to kick the wicked people that just won't do right out and let God judge them. After we have come to them and said, what you're doing is wrong. That's not judging. That's judging the sin. There's a difference between righteously judging somebody and judging somebody like you got a heaven and hell to throw them in. There's a difference, a total difference. When you judge somebody and you come at them and judging them as if you are God, then you're wrong. But if you're judging and saying what you're doing is wrong, so there's a different way you can do that. And you judge what they've done is wrong. We're to judge right and wrong. We're to judge good and bad. That's why we're here, to tell people what you're doing is wrong. Jesus is the way. How can you tell somebody that Jesus is the way without telling them that they're wrong or right in what they're doing? Some of you people are confused. And it's silly to me that you don't read the Bible enough to know that you can judge, but judge righteously. You're to judge the sin and not the person. How about that? How about I say it like that? Judge the sin and not the person. Because if you judge the person, you're wrong. Because it's not for you to judge the person. It's for you to judge the sin. Judge the right or the wrong, and that's it. All right? I'm trying to give you this. This is what we're talking about when we talk greed. See, Paul said, do not associate with the sexually immoral people. That includes some of your pastors and some of your bishops and some of your elders, some of you deacons, and some of you evangelists. Yes, you evangelists, some of you prophetesses, some of you prophets, and it includes all of you in there. It includes some of you pew sitters. It includes everybody in that. Everybody in that. No idolater or slanderer, drunkard or swindler. Okay? Because all of that's going on inside of the church. So you mean sexual immorality is going on in the church? Why, yes, it is. It's going on now. And it went on back then. So it's nothing new. Greedy people are inside of the church? Yes, it's nothing new. Let's go to 1 Peter. Because I feel like y'all need this today. I don't know why, but I do. Oh, no, I'm sorry. Not 1 Peter. Let's go to 2 Peter. Let's go to 2 Peter. 2 Peter 2, chapter 2. 2 Peter chapter 2. We're going to read 13, verse 13 through 19. And this is Peter talking to them. They will pay back with harm for the harm they have done. Their ideal of pleasure is to carouse in broad daylight. They are blots and blemishes, reveling in their pleasures while they feast with you. With eyes full of adultery, they never stop sinning. They seduce the unstable. They are experts in greed and a cursed brood. They have left the straight way and wandered off to follow the way of Balaam, son of Beor, who loved the wages of wickedness. But he was rebuked for his wrongdoing by a donkey, an animal without speech, who spoke with a human voice and restrained the prophet's madness. These people are springs without water and mist driven by a storm. The blackest darkness is reserved for them, for they mouth empty, boastful words, and by appealing to the lustful desires of the flesh, they entice people who are just escaping from those who live in error. So we're talking about the people that are just brand new Christians coming in, and they have enticed them. They have tricked them, and because they know that they're young in the faith, so they have tricked them. And they promised them freedom while themselves are slaves of depravity. For people are slaves to whatever has mastered them. Peter is deep on this one. He didn't mince words. He just basically told him. He's talking about pastors now. He's talking about people who are the head and they're the sheep. I mean, we're the sheep. He's talking about who lead the sheep. Let me put it that way. He's saying that they are experts in greed. And they seduce the unstable. Does that sound like a pastor or a prophet or a minister or a deacon or evangelist or a prophetess to you? Sounds like a few to me, but irregardless of the point, even if it sounds like, you know, okay, let's dispel this real quick. When people say, you're not supposed to talk about the man of God, you're supposed to pray for him. Yes, you are. Yes, you are supposed to pray for him. Yes, you are. You're supposed to pray for him. And no, you're not supposed to come against them and talk about them as in gossiping. You're not supposed to talk about them as in gossiping. But you can't gossip if it's truth. Do you understand that? If it's truth, there's no gossiping. And now people tend to, you know, sneak and tell and add, or gossiping, you adding a lot of, you embellishing it a little bit. But listen, if this person is an expert in greed, he seduces the unstable Christians, his eyes are full of adultery. Can you say that about that person and it not be gossip? It's truth. Let's go to 1 Kings 13. And this is the story I really want y'all to hear. because this talks about we're still talking about greed, and we're still talking about doing things that we're not supposed to do. And titles are a part of greed. Having these titles, people think that having an ascension gift of being an evangelist, a pastor, a teacher, a prophet, and a pastor, having these ascension gifts makes you more special than the people that you're supposed to be teaching. In all actuality, the apostles walk with common people, and they didn't really want to be, all they wanted to be called was, you know, a follower of Christ. Let's go to Kings real quick. First Kings, chapter 13. This whole chapter talks about a prophet, a young prophet, sent to Judah to give them a word. And King, I think his name was Josiah. Was it? No, it's King Jeroboam. I'm looking at it real quick. King Jeroboam, that's who it was. And King Jeroboam was just having a party. And the Lord sent the man of God, a young prophet, to Jeroboam and tell him, look, it's over. It's over for you. And there is no more kingdom for you. And Jeroboam wanted them killed. But the Lord gave the young prophet instructions. He gave him instructions. He said, do not eat with anybody, and do not eat bread with anybody or have a meal with anybody. Just keep going, or drink water with anybody. Just keep going to the place where I told you to go, and don't go the same way that you came. Okay. He understood that because he told the king that. But then he turned around and let a prophet that comes to him and say, I'm a prophet, and I heard from the Lord, and he said, come eat with me. Now listen to me. Everybody that says they have a word for you, I want y'all to be so close to God that when somebody says, I have a word for you, and that you can say, wait a minute, before you give me that word, you know, I know what the Lord told me, so I know, you know, what I need to do. No disrespect to you, but if you don't feel right when somebody gives you a word, then you have to go to God. I'm not saying don't receive word from God, don't receive anything like that, but everybody's word is not for you. Okay? We see a lot of things on Facebook where people, and I got reamed the other day about somebody putting something on Facebook and it had a room full of money. And they said, the Lord is going to bless you today with money. Money coming to you today. And there's a room full of money, money all over the floor. And people is going, amen. Just type amen and amen to receive your blessing from the Lord. And I'm like, that's witchcraft. Don't do that. And people was like, how do you know that's witchcraft? That could be a word for somebody. Well, that could. But what happens if they look at this room full of money and they want that room full of money and only get a dollar? Does that make that prophecy to the that glazing over prophecy? Does that make that prophecy wrong? No, money did come to them. It just came to them in a dollar. It didn't come to them in the hundreds and thousands of dollars that we saw on the floor. It came to them in a dollar. Would they still give the Lord praise for that $1? That's why it's called witchcraft. Because anytime, you know, you try to tell somebody that the Lord is going to bless you, and you're giving that to all the people, and the Lord hasn't said that to you, the Lord has given us discernment. This is what I'm trying to say. The Lord has given us discernment. you have to discern what is for you and what is for, because people will give you words sometimes because they know you, and because they want you to listen to what they have to say. And they said, the Lord told me to tell you this, and it probably really didn't even come from the Lord. We have to have discernment. So, and this story is going to tell us real quick. Let me read it real. By the word of the Lord, a man came from Judah to Bethel. As Jeroboam was standing at the altar to make an offering, by the word of the Lord, the prophet cries out against the altar. Altar, altar, this is what the Lord says. A son named Josiah will be born to the house of David. On you, he will sacrifice the priests on high places who make offerings here, and human bones will be burned on you. That same day, the man of God gave a sign that this is the sign of the Lord, that this is the sign the Lord has declared. The altar will be split apart and the ashes on it will be poured out. When King Jeroboam heard what the man of God had said, he cried out and he stretched out his hand from the altar and said, seize him. But the hand he stretched out toward the man shriveled up so that he could not pull it back. Also, the altar was split apart and his ashes poured out according to the sign given to the man of God by the word of the Lord. Now, if you read the whole story, you will see that the Lord was not joking with this young brother. But he still sat down and had something to eat with this prophet who came to him, lying to him, telling him that he had a word from the Lord. At the end of the day, the Lord told the young prophet, because you disobeyed me, you would die. The lion met him on the road after he left the other prophet. Lion met him on the road and he didn't eat him, but he mauled him and killed him. Let me tell you what King Jeroboam did after all of this was done. Even after what the prophet did to him, made his arm come back and everything else, you know, the Lord shriveled up his arm and the prophet prayed for him and made his arm come back regular. Even after that, Jeroboam did not change his evil ways, but once more started appointing priests for the high places from all sorts of people, not even Christians was in the place. He didn't care. He was just appointing everybody. Anyone who wanted to become a priest, he consecrated for high places. Did the Lord call you to be a priest, or was you just appointed by somebody who was just appointment happy? This was the sin of the house of Jeroboam that led to the downfall and the destruction from the face of the earth. His kingdom has not even been recognized because it was wiped from the face of the earth. Man, my time is running out. And that was greed. So this week we took care of greed. At least we got through greed. And what does this story have to do with greed? This story had to do with greed was because he said he tricked the young man and told him that he had a word from the Lord. And he wasn't supposed to eat or drink with nobody. He was supposed to just do what the Lord said and go on his way. But he was so greedy, he decided to go and eat and drink with the man and got killed for disobeying God. God was not playing back then. He was murking everybody. If you just disobeyed me, in the Old Testament, that's how it was. y'all was like, how can God, why did God kill? God didn't kill people. The God I know didn't kill people. I hear people say, the God I know is of love and everything. But y'all forgot, God is a God of war. He protects the people that he loves. How can he protect you if he's just all roses and cotton balls? I don't get it. I don't get why y'all think that the Lord doesn't war in protection of his people. Even the Gentiles, even us, even the regular people that's not Jewish that are Christian, he protects. And he goes to war for them. He sends his angels out. Let them handle the business. That's the way it is. That's the way it's always been in the kingdom. Yeah. My goodness, yeah. My time goes fast. I need 2 hours. I need Dr. Rhoda and Blaine to give me 2 hours. But, I mean, okay, everybody might not like that. I can think of 2 people that might not like that right now. So, anyway, I do this show so you can understand where I'm coming from. I didn't get a chance to talk about Jesus and his polygamy. See, let me explain it real quick so before my time runs out. Jesus said he was coming back for one church, a bride, and he called it the bride. It called the church his bride. If you take the bride of Jesus and match it with a Proverbs 31 woman, that's the church that Jesus is coming back for. A church that is, you know, without spot and wrinkle, that's a Proverbs 31 woman, right? Okay. So if that's the case, how can Jesus come back for a church when there's so many denominations in the church? That would make Jesus a polygamist. If you put all the different denominations in the area in Proverbs 31, and she and in her, you get so many different things that each of these women are doing. Jesus would have to be married to all of them to make one woman, and it's not even physically possible that you can have all these things from different women to make one woman and put them all together and make one woman. And you can't do it. It's not physically possible. You can't have 5 women and take one part from each of those women to make one. That's why I say we have made Jesus a polygamist, because we have so much division in us, because there's Church of God in Christ, Full Gospel Association, Baptist, AME, American Methodist, Episcopals, Presbyterian, non-denominational. All these different denominations are supposed to make up one church, and it possibly can't make up one church. That's why I say I'd rather not be called a Christian, because a Christian can be anybody nowadays. The Catholics call themselves Christians. Some Muslims call themselves Christians because they believe in the teachings of Christ, but not Jesus being the Son of God. A lot of people call themselves Christians. I'd rather you call me a follower of Christ, because that's who I'm following. That's who I'm following. I'm not following no pastor, no church, no denomination. I'm not following none of that. I'm following Christ as close to Christ as I can. I mean, I don't get it all right. Matter of fact, to let the truth be known, let me tell the truth on me. I'm just getting out of certain things that kept blessings from me. So let the truth be told. I ain't perfect. So I don't sit here like I am perfect. I put on Facebook, if you think I come at the church because I think my hands are clean, you lie to yourself, because I don't think my hands are clean. But what I do think is that we need to start handling truths in the church. Is there homosexuality in the church? Yes. Is there greed in the church? Yes. Is there division and religiosity in the church? Yes and yes. Shoot. Is there division in the church? The different denominations show that. So yes to that. Is there adultery in the church? Yes. Is there pedophilism in the church? Yes. Is there all these things inside of the church? Yes. But we don't want to deal with it, because we want to sit down and talk about how we are saved and sanctified and filled with the Holy Ghost, so there can't be nothing like that. I'll be back in a second. Okay, the portion of this program, this whole program, is brought to you by Worship Center Radio, Worship Center Networks, and Worship Center Studios, Worship Center Everything, Prophet Blaine, Dr. Rhoda Bird, and me, Juan Johnson. I'm here, the Watchman, and we're been on, but we're going off. But I got to finish this. People, we got to deal with what's wrong in the church. We can't Who are we waiting for? Are we waiting for Jesus to correct the church? Jesus wants us to correct the church so we can get better, so we can become one church, so we can get the heck out of here and be caught up with Jesus. The tribulation is coming. We got to be ready for it. Put your armor on, people. Stand, watch, and pray. I'll see y'all on Tuesday.